In this new age of social media and fake news, it's hard for consumers to distinguish what is truthful and right about agriculture, farming, and their food. So much of what they hear and read is tied up in emotions and misperceptions. Consumer engagement for our entire industry is key, but maybe we aren't engaging in the right way, and maybe and even oversharing or overreacting. Our next speaker is Leah Beyer with Elanco. Leah takes the lead on global digital communications for Elanco, a company that has really made social engagement a priority. Leah is here to tell us when it is the right time to engage and when we may just need to stop. Please join me in welcoming Leah Beyer.
All right, thank you, Jennifer. Yeah, a lot of times when I'm talking to groups that are super active in social media, I actually call this presentation "When to Shut Up." So for a few of you in the room that I know have seen my Shut Up presentation, it's a little different. So I just want to start by asking, because I talk to a lot of crowds that look like this, how many of you actually have some form of social media account, you yourself? Wow, this is awesome. This is really awesome, because sometimes I walk into a room and the token person under 40 is the only person with a social media account. So I'm proud of all of you in the room. So Elanco cares a little bit about social media. I tell people I have a lot of job security because we make everything that's controversial in animal protein. Everything. RBST, ractopamine. We have hormone implants. So I get to work at Elanco as long as Elanco's in business because I'll always have a problem. So a few years ago, actually before I even went to Elanco, our leader, Jeff Simmons, who many of you probably know, was tired of being caught on our heels. We don't know when things are coming. So they created the Elanco Pulse Institute, which, think CSI. There's screens in a large room that people are staring at all day. I mean, it's sort of like very CSI, except they're not touchscreen. And we are all day stalking people, stalking issues, stalking the food babe. Like, we sort of know now when the food babe's gonna publish something. She's a little distracted right now because she just had a baby. But we're like, oh, she's gonna post this article in 2 days based on this announcement, and then she doesn't. So we are tracking those people that make us crazy. These people who go after Monsanto, which we're thankful for Monsanto. I don't know if Monsanto's in the room, but they still get a lot of the blame for RBST, and we're grateful for that. Takes the heat off of us. The vegans, oh, the vegans. The vegans. They're always attacking someone. Always. It won't, there it goes. There's always fake news, factoids out there. And there is actually Antibiotic, who single-handedly just goes after KFC all day long, every day. So we're seeing plenty of stuff that makes our hair raise on the back of our necks. So I went in there and I was like, so just how loud are these vegans? This is how loud they are. See that blue line? That's people who hate us. See that black line that's like right above zero? That's us. That's us. But then I was like, I don't really care what vegans think of animal production because they're never gonna eat a steak, like ever. So I said, let's really dig into the food conversation. How are people talking about food? Luckily, most vegans have a gateway drug and it's called bacon. People talk about bacon like it's their religion. They talk about bright blue ice cream that probably has so many artificial things in it. We can't even number them, but it's delicious. They write poems about, oh yeah, bacon. And they talk about how much they eat. Really, really talk about food. So much that, do you see that big black line? That's just how many dairy food mentions happen in a month. Just dairy. That blue line is the activists, and that black line that's now on top of zero, that's us. So what we discovered is there's this whole void between people talking about bacon, the vegans, and us. And somehow we gotta get ourselves into that blue space. How do we talk about bacon without shooting ourselves in the foot? Here's the problem. 90 days of Twitter posts, public Twitter posts. 36 million mentions of food. 74,000 mentions of something to do with agriculture or farming. Our voice in the social space is 0.2%. Not 2%, 0.2%. So if we want to do something about what's going on, we need to start talking more. That doesn't mean fighting, but we need to just start talking about bacon. In my introduction, they talked about I'm in a global role. So in Australia, they have a lot of the same problems that we have here in the US. So we really wanted to study how far apart is the food conversation from farming and agriculture. And here it is, folks. Fashion and beauty are closer to the food conversation than agriculture is. However, and this is probably no different here in the US, if I created this in the US too, it would look very similar. Luckily, I was able to steal this off of the internet. But NGOs and social policy are closer to farming and agriculture than food is. So we're doing a decent job, at least in Australia, talking about policy that impacts agriculture, but we can't seem to talk about food. So I'm constantly being called by our customers. There's a crisis. Time Magazine, New York Times, The Food Bank. So the farmers are calling us saying, there's this food production issue, and it's huge. It's so huge. And then we go, well, is it really that big? Here's the reality. Those are the size of the conversation around food, taste, cost, and what food production actually looks like. But at the end of the day, we need some perspective. You know what people are talking about? That's what they're talking about. They don't really care what you're doing on your farm, not the real people. They're so caught up in what Donald's doing right now, they can't see straight. For those of you on social media, you probably like want to go on vacation because all your friends hate each other. Like that's all they're focused on right now. So sometimes we need perspective. So I knew this room would be full of more people who cared about GMOs than cared about antibiotics. So I got into our GMO monitoring. In the past month, as of yesterday, there have been 259,000 mentions of GMOs. You want to know who's talking about it? These people. Republican Jesus has mentioned GMOs 600 times this month. Farm Fairy Crafts has mentioned GMOs 4,050 times. Non-GMOs Verified 2,040 times. You know how many times GMOs have been mentioned by someone who has farmer or farm in their profile? In the last month? This many? These are public posts. So some people in their private lives might be talking about this, but this is people who have public posts. 1,630. And here's the people that are talking about it. So I was really proud. I'm an Illinois native. Don't judge me. Illinois corn made it up there. They mentioned GMOs 20 times in the last month. But some of those people, I don't know who they are or if they're for us or against us, but the numbers are a lot smaller. That's the math. 6% of the conversation is had by someone with farmer in their profile. So I don't know if any of you noticed over Christmas break that GMOs made this little announcement. Hunt's is now GMO free. There's not a single tomato on the vine in the fields that Hunt's gets their tomatoes from. That's newsworthy, right? No, because all tomatoes are GMO free. But what I started to watch play out on my Christmas holiday when I was trying to like not do work was that agriculture was seriously on fire, pissed at what was going on. So I fired up the engines at home and started poking around. This is what we were doing. And I'm not trying to say what high heels and canola fields did was wrong, but she did this really long, eloquent explanation about mobile DNA elements. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, this has been shared 126 times, but here's what I know about DNA. People are just as afraid of DNA as they are GMOs. So if you're using the word DNA to explain a GMO, are we really helping ourselves at all? So here's the thing. For those of you who are Twitter addicts like me, Wendy's just had what I would call an epic month. They got interacting with, I wouldn't call him a troll, but it was definitely not a smart person, about their always fresh beef, never frozen. And he sort of called him out and said, how can it not be frozen? Well, he sort of forgot about refrigeration. So he's like, are you moving the beef in hot trucks? And they're like, what do you store your food in when it's not frozen? Oh yeah, the refrigerator. So then he brings McDonald's into it. And they're like, hey dude, you don't have to do this. It's not our fault you forgot about refrigeration. So they had an epic month. And the reason I'm showing you this is I feel like Jay from Crop Life like sort of threw me a softball a little while ago. Sometimes we just have to like laugh at ourselves, poke fun at other people, and not take this too seriously. Like, come on, people forget that there's refrigeration. But that's what we do. So what Crop Life is doing, I don't know if Katie's in here, but I looked at Katie Glick and I was like, I wouldn't change a single thing about that. Finally, someone is being real. Like, come on, there's pests in the world. Let's not use DNA to explain what a GMO is. So what about other brands? There's a little tomato company here in Indiana. I am the chief procurement officer for groceries at my house. And I buy a lot of Red Gold. And I know, because I buy a lot of Red Gold, that they have been GMO verified since April. So I went investigating. What happened to Red Gold when they announced that they were GMO verified? Did they get attacked by agriculture? Did someone go up in arms, angry at Red Gold? No, this is what happened. They're fantastic. Their farmers are by us. I love them. That's my hometown. What's the difference between Hunt's and Red Gold? I don't know if you can read that, but basically they said, hey, yeah, by the way, we're GMO free and we've taken that BPA out of the cans. Oh, but still, family farmers are raising our products. So they went there, even though it makes all of us cringe a little bit, but they can. They went there, they're GMO verified free, but then they've took the focus onto family farms because, as many of you know, farmers, they're still super popular people with consumers. It's not that they don't like farmers, they love farmers. They just don't understand what we do anymore. But if we can focus on those family farmers and not those bad corporate farmers, then everything will be okay. So here's what we do on a regular basis. We're constantly, constantly following the trends. What are people talking about? When someone decides to go RBST free, whether it's Breyer's ice cream or name a cheese company, Dannon yogurt, we get the call. Since we're the ones pushing our BST. Why are they doing this? And we're like, well, we don't know, because when you think about hormones and food, it's barely showing up on the radar. No one's asking for it. So we're constantly out there talking to food companies about what the conversation's about. So from June to July, hormones actually decreased 0.5% in the overall conversation. So it's actually going down. But the reason I love to show this particular slide was this was the month of June compared to July. Anybody know what June is in the dairy industry?
Dairy month.
So here is a positive thing for agriculture. It's dairy month. We can all get around that. Eat your cheese. Go get some chocolate milk. It doesn't even show up in our monitoring as a blip on the radar. We need more people talking about the positives of dairy. It is such a small happening, we don't even mention it in our monitoring because it doesn't even register. And by the way, we can't all agree on the same hashtag half the time during dairy month. But here's the thing. So some of you might be part of the Grocery Manufacturers Association. We are. This is what I always am reminding protein producers. What people say and what people do are two different things. So people just want a good deal. They want really high quality food at affordable prices. That's why Aldi's like on fire popular now. So that blue box is everything that people are willing to buy generics of. Fresh produce, milk, bakery items, fresh meats and seafood. I don't know, gee, whole foods. You know, what are those things that haven't been processed? And then what Elenco really likes to see, because we have this other part of the business for companion animals, is that people are brand loyal when it comes to pet foods and treats and junk food. Which I get. Fake Oreos suck. I get it. But when it comes to produce, milk, non-dairy substitutes, fresh meats, people don't care what that label is. So if Tyson's in the room, I'm sorry. They don't care. They want a good deal. Here's the thing, though. I don't know. Again, I'm the grocery getter. So I know at Kroger in November, Land O'Lakes butter is on sale for $2.99 a pound. And people lose their mind over Land O'Lakes butter. I mean, I'm buying generic butter all day long, and then it's like, oh my gosh, hair on fire. How much butter is left at Kroger? I've got to go get my Land O'Lakes butter. And that's what people are talking about. Like, here it comes. Here's my favorite post of 2016. This woman is my hero. 61 pounds, people. Do you think she cares if those cows got RBST or not? She doesn't even know what RBST is, but she has 61 pounds of Land O'Lakes butter, and we thank her. So I want to rewind a little bit and talk about when we start stepping in it and when we need to sometimes shut up. So are the FFA jackets still here? These poor people have probably heard this too many times and like, shut us up talking about it. In February, something happened to our beloved National FFA organization. An organization called PETA decided to say that FFA is sort of lame as bad words. And like agriculture does, our hair got on fire. We fired back. We're gonna tell PETA how stupid they are. At that point, National FFA called us and we're like, can you like fire up the engines and tell us how bad it really is? And we're like, well, it wouldn't be so bad if you tell all those FFA members to shut up about PETA. Like, they're the amplifiers. I mean, they're going out there telling everyone to go look at PETA's blog post because they're stupid. So I'd read all these blog posts and I was like, can you call this person FFA and ask them to delete the first two paragraphs and then republish? Because they have a really great post about why you should be proud of FFA. They just took those first two paragraphs out. So I was like, I sent a message over and said, why don't we just be proud of FFA? And why don't you get those national officers out there tweeting? And why don't you call all your state officers and get them out there and let them figure out that we're FFA proud? Because right now, PETA doesn't need a PR firm because it's called agriculture. We're doing all the work for them all day long. And by the end of that, PETA, we didn't even know why we had an FFA proud moment because PETA wasn't even on the radar anymore. But we were sure all FFA proud that week. So I'm gonna take you back to my first months at Elanco. I'll be honest, I have a food blog and a drinking blog because I'm married to a farmer. So, took a little while, but you got there. There was an undercover video that happened in North Carolina. Their milk was going to none other than Harris Teeter Farms. Every farm I go to tells me their number one concern is undercover videos. Animal welfare, these activists, how do we get them out of there? Well, let me just tell you that as soon as this undercover video happened, I was like, okay, tell me what's going on. And this is what happened. I'm like, the grocery store chain, Carrie Mess, who is a blogger from Wisconsin and dairy farmer, New York farmer, were the top three promoters of the undercover video. PETA wasn't even the number one amplifier. It was one of those oh crap moments for me. Like, oh no, here we go. All the green bars are agriculture. All the blue bars, non-ag. Food industry, number one, because Harris Teeter kept saying, we don't approve of this, don't look, we don't approve, don't look, we don't approve. When if we would have just been quiet, there would have been 16 mentions. Rebecca Johnson, who worked for PETA at the time, would have been her mentions, but we couldn't help ourselves. So I want to tell a little story. I actually was in Wisconsin yesterday, because I mentioned that farms' number one concern is undercover videos. So yesterday, I pretended I was an animal activist with my colleague, and we infiltrated the largest farms in Wisconsin yesterday to see how far can we get before someone stopped us. There's a lot of gaps on a lot of farms that have trained their people to, if someone doesn't have this color shirt on, they're not allowed to take pictures. I stood in a milking parlor with four milkers for 20 minutes and no one asked me to leave. I walked behind a manure spreader shoveling out stalls in a calf barn for 30 minutes and no one asked me to leave. If you have a facility, If you have a farm, you got to make sure that every employee on that farm feels empowered to tell people to get the hell out. Because more videos are going to keep happening. If someone like me, who was dressed not like someone who knew what happened on a farm, with nice shoes and nice clothes and furry hats, we looked as out of place as we could. We finally would get told to kicked off the farm, but we have probably an hour and a half worth of video on a farm. I got sick pens. We got cows calving. We got so much stuff. So I'm telling you this because if this is your fear, you better make sure everyone in your organization's empowered to kick people out of your facilities. So are we doing it right yet? Anybody remember that Subway announcement in 2015 when they decided to go antibiotic free? Then agriculture got really mad. Remember that? Got really mad. See that second to the end button right there? Right before 11-1? That's a Subway announcement. The largest antibiotic announcements back in 2015 were driven by McDonald's and Tyson, and they were extremely large. So we're doing better at coming together. We showed up, but it wasn't quite loud enough. Now, we did turn the tide on Subway to a point, but we all in this room, if you didn't raise your hand with a social media account, you maybe want to think about getting one where you actually post something to it. If you have a social media account in the room and you don't post, you might want to start thinking about posting. We need more people. We, in my house, have chosen to not eat a Chipotle or Panera. Now, granted, my husband doesn't really like chicken, so Panera was an easy out. But we also don't eat at Chipotle, and we always get really pissed at Chipotle. But I wanted to share this with you. They're not driving the largest voice share. And let me just tell you, from our research, the reason that 50% of the conversation is Purdue chicken and McDonald's is because they buy it. So here's my little plug for all your communicators back at the office. Give those people some money. We need to promote what we're talking about if we want to get our message out there. So I get that you do, sorry news media, I know you do radio ads, and I know you do print ads, but we also need to be in that social space because we're losing ground to two companies, letting them own it, and we don't always agree with them. And here's my plug for Facebook. It's the largest social media account. In the United States, 69% of adults have a social media account. 69%. So you guys are not a normal case study, but 69%. And that is where fear is driven. So here's the thing. Sometimes we get punched in the gut, and we get punched hard. Memorial Day weekend, a hog producer in this country had an undercover video launched. Their packer immediately said, "We're done. We're not taking your pigs." This was in a gestation stall-free barn. For those of you who have been in a gestation stall-free barn, sometimes it's not so lovely. Sometimes it's perfectly fine, but sometimes it's not. So they had this really not great undercover video. They immediately wanted to put out a statement, both the packer and the producer. And we told them that if you're only at 800 mentions, you probably want to shut up and not say anything and let something happen. Do you guys remember what else happened Memorial Day weekend in this country? There's this zoo in Cincinnati that had a gorilla that had a little kid fall in it, and he got shot. So here's what I'm gonna tell you. If you have an undercover video hit your facility, you need a zoo to kill a gorilla. Because it was like so epic that I feel like I should tell this story all the time. They ended up having about 1,600 mentions of their undercover video. Their packer got called out several times, but just by the vegans who are never gonna buy that packer's goods anyways. And we were able to keep that farm from a complete PR crisis. That gorilla had over 1 million mentions in 3 days. Over 1 million mentions. So I'm telling you, get a gorilla to get killed and your issues will go away. So here's the thing, how beautiful it is to stay silent when someone expects you to be enraged. So that packer, that farmer, they stayed silent. So in November, they called us again and were like, "Well, we don't think we have a problem, but can you go do some research for us?" So change.org had a petition. I love change.org. You know, like these people start these petitions and they're like, we need 150,000 signatures. And then I'm like, and then what? Like, do you think people really care if you got 150,000 signatures? But what I love most about this is, remember what the video was about? A gestation stall free barn? They're promoting the change.org about abuse and showing gestation stalls. Like, these people can't get it. They can't figure out if they're for gestation stalls or against gestation stalls. But again, because the packer and the producer stayed silent, they had to come back for more. They didn't think they got enough bang for the buck. So it's working. It really is. So here's the thing. I know way too much about search engine optimization. If you see something negative in the news, I want you all to figure out how to print a PDF of a news story. Stop spreading those links around. Don't email those links, just send those PDFs. Because when you see something that gets you mad, what's the first thing you do? You fire off an email to like 700 of your closest friends. And then they click on it, and we're helping Google say, this is a really important article, you should send it on up, that search engine when we Google. So I want you all to go back and print those PDFs of those articles. Don't link or mention. If you've got PETA at your back door, or if you've got those March Against Monsanto people at your back door, don't mention them. Shut up. And then pay attention to who's actually sharing. So during that Hunt's fiasco over Christmas, I quickly realized it was just agriculture sharing this Hunt's thing, and we looked sort of rough. So if you don't see someone who is not ag sharing something, don't share it. Do not share it. So pay attention to those things. So to conclude, promote what you love and just ignore the haters altogether, because like Taylor Swift says, haters are gonna hate. So, any questions? I think Jennifer is around to run a microphone. If there are any questions.
Any questions, yeah.
Any questions for Leah?
See, I wowed them so much. Mm-hmm. Or they're stuck.
Got their wheels turning.
They're thinking about Oreos.
Right there. Right
there. Hey, just a little off your subject. Okay. A little bit off the subject, but this, you know, food companies caving into groups. I'll use cage-free eggs.
Yeah, cage-free. I love that
so
example.
All these companies are coming out saying they're only going to use cage-free eggs.
In their mayonnaise.
And certain people understand if they want it, they can buy them, but in the stores, most people really don't care, but yet we're forced. You're almost looking like the whole industry might be forced to go cage-free when it's really not the consumer, it's the companies caving in. So any ideas how to combat that?
So here's the struggle with that. You have a marketer. Let's talk about Hellmann's low-fat mayonnaise, because that's a product I have in my fridge that is cage-free, and they have a picture of those cute little brown eggs on it. They have a marketer trying to market low-fat Hellmann's mayonnaise. And that marketer has been tasked with a win that their bonus is tied to steal a half a percentage share from low-fat Miracle Whip. So that's what we're combating. So that's why when you think about how we're going to combat that issue, we're sending people into those food companies to meet directly with those marketers. Because at the end of the day, they want their bonus. So how do those people get a bonus without doing something niche? So if we do not take them ideas on how to differentiate their product without going to production methods, we're going to continue losing this battle. So it's all about how do we get to that marketer? Because that marketer is going to be there for 2 years, and then they're going to go market regular Hellmann's mayonnaise because they rock it. So how can you increase the shares of sale of regular Hellmann's? So we've got to figure out how to get to those marketers. And some of that can be through social media. Let me just tell you, we're doing that. But it comes to relationships. Are we talking to the VP of marketing at the companies, but are we talking to the marketers? So that's one thing we really have to do more of.
Other questions for Leah?
Yes.
So if you were using social media to broaden your business,
yeah.
Which one would be the best? And as a second question, is there a new one coming out that we should be?
So it's all about audience. So I'm wearing your shirt, you're an Umbarger. You're selling to livestock farmers or 4-H kids or all of the above. So where are your customers at? So I, most of the time I'm like, listen, most people are on Facebook. They might have a Twitter account, but they're comfortable on Facebook. So if I was on Barger feed, I'd make sure I was posting on Facebook. I would singularly focus there because only about 19 to 20% of all adults in the United States have a Twitter account. If you have a demographic though, which you do, that's under 30, they are living on Instagram and Snapchat. And before you all freak out, I'm not saying you need to have a Snapchat account, but maybe your employees need to make sure they do so they see what your customers are talking about if they're that under 30. Now, don't be creepy and go creep on, you know, little kids, but if I were you, and I know you're big in the show feed industry, I'd be all over promoting your customers on Instagram. People love to see their face. And you can do the same thing in Facebook. The great thing about Instagram is Facebook controls it. So you can post in one place and shoot it to both. So if I were you, I'd be all over Facebook and Instagram and encourage your employees to be on Snapchat, which they probably are. Everyone on my team is younger than me. So they talk to me all day on Snapchat. So I've been forced to like really embrace it because they don't text me, they Snapchat me. So it might be something where it's an employee engagement.
We have time for one more question. Yes, back there.
So, Jay with CropLife. So, Leah, you're a big company. How do you manage your law department in using all of the social media?
How do I manage my law department?
Yes.
I talk to them all the time. And I don't let them tell me no. So I'm pretty tight with the North American General Counsel because that's where we do most of our stuff. Unfortunately, when you're a highly regulated pharmaceutical company, even in the animal health space, in Europe, we can't even talk about our products on our website, let alone social media like Dream On. It's not going to happen. So for us, I'm in the lawyer's office more than I'm probably in anyone's office. So we want to do this. How can I get you to say yes? So it's always like, don't tell me no, because I'm going to come back for more. So they finally realize that I don't take no for an answer. And they're like, okay, you can't do this, but you can do that. So they're incredibly supportive. I will say, if you have a executive who's super supportive and can sort of talk to legal for them, it helps the communications department. So having Jeff Simmons as our advocate is a huge benefit.
Well, thank you, Leah, for sharing the time.